Yashurandana Braja Janarandana. Yashurandana Braja Janarandana. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari.
Chaitanya Charitamrit, Madhya Lila, Chapter 8, Text 100. Anaya Radhito Noonam. Bhagavan Haririshwaraha. Yanno Vihaya Govindaha. Prito Yam Anayadraha. Anayaradhito Noonam. Bhagavan Haririshwaraha.
Bhagavan Haririshwaraha.
Yanno Vihaya Govindaha.
Vihaya Govindaha.
Prito Yam Anayadraha.
Prito Yam Anayadraha.
Anayaradhito Noonam. Bhagavan Haririshwaraha.
Bhagavan Haririshwaraha.
Yanno Vihaya Govindaha.
Yanno Vihaya Govindaha.
Prito Yamana Yadraha.
Vito Yama Yadraha.
her. Aradhitaha, worshipped. Nunam, indeed. Bhagavan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Harihi, Krishna. Ishvaraha, the Lord. Yat, from which. Naha, us. Vihaya, rejecting. Govindaha, Lord Sri Krishna. Pritaha, satisfied. Yam, whom. Anayat, brought. Raha, a secluded place. Translation purport by His Divine Grace, Isi Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation: when the gopis began to talk among themselves, they said, "Dear friends, the gopi who has been taken away by Krishna to a secluded place must have worshipped the Lord more than anyone else." Purport: the name Radha is derived from this verse, Bhagavatam 10:30-28. From the word Anaya Radhitaha, meaning by her the Lord is worshipped. Sometimes the critics of Srimad Bhagavatam find it difficult to find Radharani's holy name in that book. But the secret is disclosed here in the word Aradhita, from which the name Radha has come. Of course, the name of Radharani is directly mentioned in other Puranas. This gopi's worship of Krishna is topmost, and therefore her name is Radha, or the topmost worshipper. Om Jnana Timirandhasya Jnananjanishalakaya Chakshuronmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Itinamine. Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. I'm grateful to be here, and I seek the blessings of all the senior Vaishnavas so that I can try to speak something about the exalted subject of Srimati Radharani on her auspicious appearance day. Anayaradhito Nunam Bhagavan Haririshwaraha. So the gopis are speaking, Anaya, this particular gopi, Aradhito, he must have worshipped in a very special way, the Lord, and that's why he has left us and taken her alone with him. This verse comes in the Rasa Panchadhyaya of the Srimad Bhagavatam. The Srimad Bhagavatam has 900 chapters, out of which 335 chapters, out of which 90 chapters are in the third, in the 10th canto. And among those, chapters 29 to 33 are considered the Rasa Panchadhyaya. Pancha is five, Adhyaya is chapters. So Panchadhyaya refers to the five chapters, and Rasa refers to the five chapters which describe the Rasleela. And the broad division of the five chapters is that the 29th chapter, Krishna plays his flute and calls the gopis to come to him. And in the 30th chapter, after they have some initial discussions, Krishna disappears from the gopis. First he takes one gopi with him. First the gopis think that Krishna has disappeared entirely from all of us. But then as they are tracing Krishna's footprints, they see that Krishna has gone with one gopi. And at that point, they're speaking this verse. And eventually Krishna leaves that gopi also. And then all the gopis, they go as deep into the forest as possible to try to find Krishna. But when they are not able to find, it's such thick forest that even they can't see their hand in front of themselves because of the darkness. Then they again come back. And they come back to the banks of the Yamuna. And there they start reciting prayers, begging Krishna to reappear. And those prayers are the famous Gopi Gita, which is given in the 31st chapter. And in the 32nd chapter, by the end of these fervent prayers, Krishna appears once again. And then the gopis and Krishna have a discussion. The gopis are somewhat angry with Krishna. How could you leave us like this and go away? We had left everything and come to you. And at the same, they're somewhat angry, but at the same time, they're also apprehensive. If they get too angry with Krishna, Krishna may go away again. So they're partially expressing their anger, they're partially not expressing. There is some very indirect language they use. I'll come to that a little later. But then, after that discussion, Krishna satisfies them. And in the 33rd chapter, the gopis perform Rasa Lila with Krishna. I mean, they all dance and they perform this celebrated pastime. Now, it is in this section of the Bhagavatam that the identity of Radharani is revealed indirectly. Actually, Prabhupada mentions in the purport that the name is derived from Anaya Radhita. So, one who worshipped and who one worshipped in the best possible way. Now, of course, in the Brahma Puran, in the Brahma Vivarta Puran, in the Padma Puran, several other Puranas, Radharani is not only name is mentioned, her pastimes are also described. But actually, in the Bhagavatam, there is not much mention. And the reason for that, as given by Acharyas, is that Shukadeva Goswami, although he is in deep ecstasy, remembering Krishna's pastimes, still his ecstasy is subordinated to his mood of service. He knows that he is there speaking the Bhagavatam to serve Parikshit Maharaj, to help Parikshit Maharaj remember Krishna. And he himself, Shukadeva Goswami, is described by Acharyas that he is actually the parrot of Srimati Radharani in the spiritual world, a very intimate associate of Radharani. And thus, if he starts directly speaking about her, he will go into such a deep ecstasy that he will just lose all external consciousness. He may even swoon in ecstasy. And how long he will be in internal consciousness, that is unpredictable. And therefore, he feels that he is there to serve Parikshit Maharaj, he has to speak about Krishna. But if he himself loses himself in ecstasy, then he will not be able to speak about Krishna. So therefore, he does not directly mention Radharani's name. And does he, the mention of Radharani's name and the explicit description of Radharani's pastimes would have put him in such extraordinary ecstasy that he would no longer be able to do his service. So therefore, Parikshit Maharaj, to serve Parikshit Maharaj, Shukadeva Goswami mentions indirectly. Actually, Prabhupada also, we see that he was very cautious in talking about Srimati Radharani. In fact, in the whole Bhagavad Gita, nowadays with the big Gita available online, in digital format, we can search. Now, how many times does Srila Prabhupada refer to Radharani? Actually, in the whole Bhagavad Gita, Prabhupada refers to Radharani only once. And where is that? In the introduction when he is offering the prayer, Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Rishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye. That is the only place in the whole Bhagavad Gita that Srila Prabhupada refers to Radharani. He is very cautious. I have a friend in the Sri Vaishnava tradition. He says, you know, you ISKCON people have got it all wrong. He says, what do you mean? So he said that when you refer to Radha, you have a double honorific for her. You have Srimati also before and you have Rani after that. So Srimati Radharani. But when you refer to Krishna, you don't use any honorific at all. There is no Shri Krishna, no Bhagwan Krishna. Now how is this? Krishna is God. So I explained to him that actually, you know, even for Krishna, Prabhupada was very reverential. Prabhupada, in fact, He had his own coinage. He used the word the Supreme Personality of Godhead, which is a very distinctive coinage to convey the supreme position of Krishna. At the same time, Prabhupada wanted us to develop a personal relationship with Krishna. And these devotees who were with Prabhupada, they often felt Krishna was like a living, loving presence with them. When Prabhupada was there, one of Srila Prabhupada's disciples, Haigaru Prabhu, he says that, when they told him to start Back to Godhead magazine, they said, Prabhupada, we have never done anything except read a magazine. We don't know how to run a magazine. Prabhupada said, don't worry, you pray to Krishna, Krishna will help you. So it's almost as if Krishna is a person who is readily available. We just pray to him, he will guide us. So for Prabhupada, Krishna was a very real presence. And he wanted us to also connect with Krishna. So in that sense, Prabhupada does talk about Krishna's greatness, Krishna's position. But the personal reference to Krishna is meant to emphasize a personal relationship with him. At the same time, because the position of Radharani is very exalted, and more than exalted, it is easily misunderstandable. And not just is it easily misunderstandable, it has also been widely misunderstood. Because of which, Srila Prabhupada was especially cautious. It has been widely misunderstood, not just in the broad understanding of Indian literature, of the Vedic literature, but specifically in our own Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition also, it has been misunderstood. It has been misrepresented. And that's why Prabhupada, following in the footsteps of his spiritual master, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur, was very cautious when talking about Radharani. And Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur would quote the biblical saying, fools rush in where angels fear to tread. He said that if we trespass into the exalted pastimes of Srimati Radharani with Krishna, that will be inappropriate. It can actually harm our devotion. So I will talk about this, about Radharani from a philosophical, historical and applicational or personal perspective today in the morning. In the evening, I'll talk about some pastimes of Srimati Radharani also. So in the previous, we've been having 3-4 sessions on Gaudiya Vaishnavism, where we talked about how the concept of God in both his greatness and his sweetness is revealed in a very vivid way in the Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition. Now, having said that, actually, there is a fundamental understanding about God which is vital if we are to not misunderstand him. And that is that God is not just another being in a hierarchy of beings. I mentioned this briefly earlier, but that sometimes we may say, okay, like in a, say in a tennis tournament now, if a tennis, so there may be number 10 player, number 9 player, number 8 player, and then number 1 player. So there's a hierarchy, and then there's number 1 player who's the top of the hierarchy. Now tomorrow, if a second player, second ranked player starts playing better, then he may become the number 1 player. So sometimes you may conceive that there's a hierarchy of beings, and God is at the top of the hierarchy. Now this understanding is sometimes given, but that is only one understanding. Now God is not just the best of all beings, he is the basis of all being. Nothing can exist without him. So it is not that there are 100 different beings and God is a separate being. No, all the 100 beings, they exist because of God. Natadasti vinayatsyan mayabhutam characharam. That Krishna says, nothing can exist without me. And that means all living beings are ultimately dependent on Krishna for their existence. In fact, not only are they dependent on Krishna, the understanding is all living beings are expanded from Krishna. So we could approach the understanding of God and how all living beings relate with him from our perspective. And you see, okay, this devotee has this relationship with Krishna. This devotee has this relationship with Krishna. So some devotees are Shantaras, some devotees are in Dasyaras, some in Sakya, some in Vatsalya, and some in Madhurya. So this is from the devotee's perspective, we can see what is the mellow in which, what is the relationship's flavor in which they are approaching Krishna. From other perspective, when we see, from Krishna's perspective, actually everybody who exists is expanded from him. Aham sarvasya prabhavo mattaha sarvam pravartate. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, everything emanates from me. All of existence is sustained by me. And this is especially important to understand when we come to the concept of Madhurya Ras. Madhurya Ras is where Krishna reciprocates in a loving mood with his devotees. Which mood? There is a mood of Madhurya, that is conjugal affection. Actually, the relationship of the gopis with Krishna is of, we could say, romantic attraction. It's the male-female attraction. And that attraction is the most powerful force in this world. And it often, this attraction often spins out of control, and people often end up doing many immoral and devious things in trying to fulfill their mutual attraction to each other. But in the case of Krishna with the gopis, the first thing to understand, Chaitanya Charitamrita explains is, Radha Krishna Eka Atma Dui Deha Dhari, that Radha and Krishna are actually one person. Dui Deha Dhari, they are manifested in two bodies. So when a man and a woman have a relationship with each other, they may metaphorically say, you know, we two are one. If two people love each other, they may say, you know, we two are one. But they're not one, they are two distinct persons. But with respect to Radha and Krishna, actually, it's one person who has manifested as two. For anyonyana vilase, for what purpose? For the purpose of reciprocating love, for the purpose of performing pastimes. And this understanding that for the purpose of performing pastimes, the absolute truth expands in various ways. This is very important. Now, in the European tradition, there was the Greek tradition, there was the idea, Aristotle had the idea of God as the unmoved mover. He says that God, or whatever we call the source of everything, is the mover, is the first agent who moves everyone. But then he says that if God is perfect, then he should not have any change in him. He is the unmoved mover, because whenever any motion happens, any change happens, that is because there is something incomplete or uncomfortable about the previous situation. Or there's something desired in some other situation because of which we act. So if God is perfect, then why should he act at all? So the idea was, say, God is like a frozen perfection. It's like if somebody is making a painting. You know, those who are painters, they know that actually, when a painting is being made initially, each dab that we put with the painting, it adds to the beauty. And at a particular point, the painting becomes the best it can be. And after that, if you put even one more brush of the paintbrush, actually the beauty goes down. So before that, the beauty is not that great. After that, the beauty is not that great. At that particular point, the beauty is the highest. And you shouldn't touch it. That is the idea in painting. So the idea of God became like a frozen perfection. You know, God in a perfect state, and if he does anything, then that means his perfection will be impeded. Because if God were truly perfect, why would he want to do anything at all? Because he's perfect. Normally, whenever we act, there are two purposes why we act. Yasmat priya priya viyoga sanyoga janna. And Prahlad Maharaj prayers, he said that sometimes there is something which is apriya for us, something which is we don't like, and we want to get rid of that. That's why we act. Or sometimes there is something priya, something dear which we don't have, and because of that we act. So now if God is perfect, then there can be nothing desirable which he wants, and there can be nothing undesirable which he wants to avoid. So why would he act at all? Now this idea of God as a frozen perfection may sound conceptually very pleasing. Oh, God is perfect. But it's personally not at all attractive. Why should God have any attraction at all? Now, this same question is deliberated in the Vedanta Sutra by various acharyas. And the Vedic scriptures also say that na vidyate isacha janma karma va, that the absolute truth does not do any karma. The absolute truth does not do any action. Now, Ramanujacharya in his commentary on the Vedanta Sutra says that actually when the absolute truth acts, now we see that the absolute truth performs many pastimes. So why does the Lord perform pastimes if he is perfect? So Ramanujacharya says that actually it is not karma, it is kreeda. It is not action or work, it is simply play. It's like a person may be having a job in his office and he goes to the they go to their office and come back. And after that they just want to play. They may play some golf or some tennis. Now there is no purpose of getting any result by it. Just playing for enjoyment. So in that sense he says it is not karma. Now Baldev Vidya Bhushan in his commentary takes this point further. And he says actually even when we play, the play is for pleasure. We want relaxation, we want a break, we want enjoyment. So he says the absolute truth's activity is not like a play, it is like a dance. Now say somebody is very happy and in happiness they start dancing. They don't dance. When we play to enjoy, play to become happy. But when we dance because we are already happy. And that happiness that is within is expressed through dancing. So like that, he says the leela, the activity that the Lord performs, is simply an expression of his exuberant ecstasy. So when the Lord expands, when the Lord does any activity, and one activity is he expands. When he expands, it is simply to express his exuberant ecstasy. He does not need anything from anyone. He is complete in himself. So there are sometimes when we go to someone, you know, somebody may be hungry and they may go to someone else because they feel incomplete, I need food. There may be somebody else who has eaten a lot of food and they have got extra food with them. Then they go to someone to share that food. It is not, they are going, it is not because of, to remove their incompleteness, it is to share their completeness. Normally, whenever we form relationships in the world, we have some sense of incompleteness. You know, I'm alone, I want a partner, I want a friend. So we form relationships out of a sense of incompleteness which we want to end. But with respect to Krishna, when he forms relationships, it is simply to share his completeness. And the agency with which he reciprocates love the most, that agency is Srimati Radharani. So Radharani is the Ladini Shakti of Krishna. Ladini Shakti is the pleasure-giving potency. And this means that Ladini Karai Krishna Ananda Aswadana Ladini Dwara Krishna Kare Bhaktera Poshana. So to describe that this Ladini Shakti, which manifests Srimati Radharani, she performs two functions. One is Ladini Karai Krishna Ananda Aswadana. Ladini Shakti gives pleasure to Krishna. And second is Ladini Dwara Krishna Kare Bhaktera Poshan. Ladini nourishes the hearts of the devotees. So how does this work? So first of all, now before we look at Radharani as a feminine personality, we have to understand her philosophical position. She is Krishna himself who has manifested as the energy that gives him pleasure. So Krishna is complete in himself. And when Krishna desires to share his completeness, he desires to express his ecstasy, at that time he manifests as another person. And that another person who manifests is Radharani. So Radha and Krishna in the sense are Radha Krishna Eka Atma Dui Dehadhari. They are one soul who manifests in two forms. And they reciprocate love. So with this understanding, what is further implied? Krishna does not need anything external for his pleasure. And Radharani is not someone external to him. She is actually Krishna himself who is manifested in another form. But not only is she manifested in another, not only is she Krishna manifested in another form, she is also having her own mood and her own service. Her own mood, her own role. And in that way, when she functions as a different person. She functions with her own free will. Now that free will is entirely for the pleasure of Krishna. But sometimes she pleases Krishna by doing what Krishna wants her to do. And sometimes she pleases Krishna by acting in a different way. That also enhances the sweetness of the love. So when Radharani, she performs various pastimes, by the way she acts, everything that she does, actually it enhances Krishna's pleasure. In the Radhika Ashtakam, which is a set of 8 verses composed by Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami to glorify Shrimati Radharani. So it is said over there, Kumkumatma Kanchanabja Garvahari Gaurabha Pitananchitanja Abjagandha Kirti Nindi Saurabha Ballavesha Sunu Sarva Vanchitartha Sadhika Mahyamatma Pada Padma Dasya Dastu Radhika. So all the verses in the Radhikashtam come, they end with this chorus. Mahyam Atma Pada Padma Dasya Dastu Radhika. Oh Radharani, please give me the service of your lotus feet. And while with this prayer, he describes the glory of Shrimati Radharani. So he's describing the beauty of her complexion, Kumkumatma Kanchanabja Garvahari Gaurabha. That gold is very attractive. And gold is Kumkum is also very attractive, golden color. And it says all of their beauty that is there, it is all put to shame by the beauty of Radharani's complexion. Pita Nanchitabja Gandha Kirti Nindi Saurabha. Lotus flowers are very beautiful. But actually Radharani's delicate beauty is so great that the lotus is put to shame in front of her. And Ballavesha Sunu Sarva Vanchit Artha Sadhika. Ballavesha Sunu. Ballavesha is Nanda Maharaj. Sunu is the son of Nanda Maharaj, that is Krishna. Whatever Sarva Vanchita, whatever is the desire that Krishna has, Sadhika. So Radhika is the Sadhika. Radhika is Radharani, it's one of her names. Sadhak, sadhana is the means. The feminine in poetic form of sadhana is sadhika. She is the means by which all of Krishna's desires are fulfilled. So in this way, actually Shrimati Radharani, who is Krishna manifesting to give pleasure to Krishna. It is Krishna manifesting to give pleasure to Krishna. And she has one more very important function. What is it is said that? Ladini karaye Krishna ananda aswadan. Ladini gives pleasure to Krishna and Ladini dwara Krishna kare bhaktera posha. That Ladini nourishes the hearts of the devotees. What this means is that whenever we practice bhakti, whenever we try to serve Krishna, whenever we try to love Krishna, at that time, whenever we experience any higher taste, whenever we experience any joy, whenever we experience the sweetness of Krishna, that is actually the result of the mercy of Shrimati Radharani. So Ladini Shakti manifests in our heart. And when she manifests in our heart, then we experience ecstasy. So what this means is, Krishna is spiritual, Krishna is transcendental, Krishna is infinite. Now we are in material consciousness, we are finite, we are caught in this world. How possibly can our service reach Krishna? So when we try to serve Krishna, when we try to chant his holy names, when we try to speak his glories, based on the sincerity of our effort, actually it is Radharani who becomes pleased. And then that Radharani acts as the connection between us and Krishna. So when we offer bhoga to the deities, actually how the mood is that we offer to a spiritual master. Spiritual master offers his parampara and then it goes to Radharani. And Radharani offers it to Krishna. And when Radharani offers it to Krishna, Krishna cannot refuse. Krishna delightfully accepts it. And then he gives his mercy. So So Radharani ultimately is the connecting link between us and Krishna. Of course, for the functional purposes in this world, the Guru is the connecting link. In the spiritual world, in the inner affairs, in the spiritual world, Radharani is the connecting link. Even the spiritual master, his service to Krishna goes through Radharani. So in that sense, it is Radharani's service that pleases Krishna. And whenever we do any service, it is when that service reaches Radharani and Radharani offers it to Krishna, it is then that service pleases Krishna. And when that service pleases Krishna, then our heart becomes permeated with ecstasy. We start getting some glimpse of spiritual taste. So this Radharani is in that sense vital for our spiritual advancement. It is by her mercy that we get the taste by which we can give up the lower tastes of this world. So Radharani is Krishna manifested in a separate form for the purpose of serving Krishna. And in that mood, her mood is a mood of complete selflessness. She will do whatever it takes to please Krishna. And in this particular pastime, this is illustrated in the Rasa Leela, where Krishna plays the flute and calls the gopis. When he calls the gopis leave everything and just come. And among all those gopis, the foremost, the gopi with the strongest desire who comes to Krishna is Radharani. Now, it is generally understood that in the pursuit of God, the bad has to be given up. You know, if we have some sinful tendencies, if we have some bad habits, those negativities have to be given up. That is vital. But actually, for the sake of God, not only has the bad to be given up, but even the good has to be given up. God alone is the object of our devotion, beyond the bad and beyond the good. That does not mean that the good has to be rejected, or not that the good is treated at the same level as the bad, but rather, for the sake of God, everything has to be given up. And this is said in the concluding verse of the Bhagavad Gita. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja. So I was invited to speak on the Gita Jayanti at a program organized by a Hindu guru, and they were reciting the Bhagavad Gita's important verses. And when they came to this 18.66, they recited it, Sarva adharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja. So I said, Sarva adharman parityajya. Give up all adharma and surrender to me. Now, Krishna and Bhagavad Gita doesn't say Sarva adharman parityajya. Krishna says Sarva dharman parityajya. Give up all dharma and surrender to me. So then I asked them, after the talk, why did you change this dharman to adharman? So they said, actually, Krishna has said that he has come to establish dharma. Dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. If Krishna has come to establish dharma, then how can he tell anyone to give up dharma? So they quoted some scholar. He said that actually, when the Bhagavad Gita was written down over many generations, somebody forgot to write a... Oh. So they said there was a... Sarva adharman was there, but somebody forgot to write a... So now we are putting that a back. Now, actually, this is a complete misunderstanding. Because Arjuna, if you see, I look at it from the context, and then we look from the philosophy. Philosophy is what will apply to Radharani's example also. That actually, for Arjuna, he's already a virtuous person. There is no question of adharma for him. Arjuna, at the start of the Gita, was actually conflicted between two dharmas. His Kula Dharma and his Kshatriya Dharma. His Kula Dharma was his dynastic duty. And as per the Kula Dharma, he was meant to protect his family members. If our family members, if our relatives, they're in trouble, we are meant to help them. So Kula Dharma required him to take care of his relatives. But Kshatriya Dharma, as a Kshatriya, as a martial guardian of society, he was required to punish those who were disrupting Dharma. So, now what if one's own relatives are the disruptors of dharma? So his Kula Dharma and his Kshatriya Dharma were pulling him in two different directions. And that's why Arjuna did not know what to do. And so for Arjuna, whether to do dharma or adharma was not the question. For Arjuna, the question was which dharma to do. And Krishna tells Arjuna that you don't get caught in the technicalities of dharma. Understand that the ultimate purpose of all dharma is Mam Ekam Sharanam Braja. Surrender to me. And for that dharma, for doing that dharma, whatever activity you have to do, you do that. So Krishna is telling Arjuna, yes, Kshatriya dharma is also laudable, Kula dharma is also laudable. But the most laudable principle is Mam Ekam Sharanam Braja. Just surrender to me. And you do whatever way you can surrender to me, you should do that. So in Arjuna's context, it was he the Kshatriya dharma, he fought. And that's how he surrendered to Krishna. But the point of the verse is that for the sake of surrendering to Krishna, even the good can be given up. So now, when Krishna played his flute and he called the gopis, for the gopis and for Radharani to go at that time when Krishna is calling. Now this could be seen as adharmic. Now for a woman to at night to go all alone to meet some man with whom she has no, whom she is not married, that could be seen as adharmic. And especially in a conservative society, now for a woman, her reputation is very important. Her chastity is very important. If a woman is considered unchaste, then it becomes like a big stigma on her. Now the gopis, they were never unchaste because they were eternally Krishna's associates. Radharani is Krishna himself. But when Krishna called the gopis, when he called Radharani, at that time, Radharani left everything. No matter what the world thinks, it doesn't matter. Pati sutanvaya bhratra bandhavan ati vilangyate antyachyutagatah. So later in the Gopi Gita, the gopis pray that, oh Krishna, we left everyone for your sake. Our family members were telling us, don't go. But still we left it all and came to you. And he says, how is it that we left everything and we came to you and now you are leaving us and going away? Kitava yoshitas kastya jenashi. How is it, Krishna, that you are leaving us and going away now? Please come back. That is the mood over there. So actually when the gopis leave everything and come to Krishna, at that time they are demonstrating the principle of sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam braja. They are ready to give up everything for Krishna's sake. Of course, Shukadeva Goswami describes that the devotees are ready to give up everything for Krishna's sake. But Krishna protects his devotees. So, eventually when the gopis after the Rasleela come back, at that time their family members, Krishna has arranged that there is another form of the gopis there with them. So that the family members think that the gopis did not go out at all. They thought that we were wanting to go out, we stopped them and they didn't go. So Krishna arranges through Yogamaya to protect the reputation of the gopis. But the point is they are ready to give it all up for Krishna. And then as the gopis come out and they meet Krishna, so here I am talking about the theme of how Radharani demonstrates complete selflessness in her love for Krishna. So her selflessness is that she is ready to even sacrifice her reputation. Her reputation of chastity she is ready to sacrifice for Krishna's sake. And then the gopis and Krishna talk with each other. Krishna plays with the gopis. He says, Krishna, oh gopis, he says, you're a young woman. You should not come out like this at night. And then Krishna says, why? So then Krishna says, oh, probably you had a desire to see the beauty of the forest at night. So now you've seen the beauty of the forest, now you can go back. And the gopis start scratching the ground with their feet. That is the way they describe the restlessness. Why is Krishna speaking like this with us? Speaking so formally with us. The gopi says, Krishna, you know why we have come here. You have called us. That's why we have come. So finally, when Krishna sees the intense desire of the gopis, then Krishna and the gopis start performing rasa. They start dancing together. And at that time, as they are dancing together, what happens thereafter is understood at multiple levels. And to understand the significance of this verse, we'll look at the various levels. So as the gopis are dancing with Krishna, it is said at one level that the gopis start becoming proud. And when the gopis become proud, then Krishna leaves them and goes away. And he takes Radharani with him. And then it is said that Radharani becomes proud. And when Radharani becomes proud, even Krishna leaves Radharani and go away. And in this way it is said that actually where there is pride, Krishna is not there. Even the topmost devotees, if they become proud, then Krishna will not be there. But here, in this section, in the Ramanandara and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu Samvad, it is described that Krishna leaves the gopis not so much because they become proud. Krishna leaves the gopis because he wants to demonstrate to the world the speciality of the love of Srimati Radharani. That, yes, we are, all the gopis love Krishna greatly, but Radharani's love stands distinctively apart. And to demonstrate the speciality of that love, you know, Krishna takes Radharani alone away. And that's why in this verse, the gopis are recognizing, oh, Krishna has gone with one gopi. But they also are, they are not thinking Krishna is partial. They are thinking that this gopi, Pritoyam Anayadraha, this gopi must have pleased Krishna in a special way. This gopi must have worshipped Krishna much more than us. That's why Krishna has taken her. So the gopis are not ascribing partiality to Krishna. Sometimes this question is raised, is God partial or is he impartial? Especially the seventh canto of the Bhagavatam, Parikshit Maharaj asked this question that, you know, that when Krishna kills the demons and he delivers the devatas, so is he partial or is he impartial? So the answer is quite philosophical, but if you put it in a succinct way, it is Krishna is impartially partial. Krishna is impartially partial. What does that mean? Krishna is no doubt partial to his devotees, but he keeps the door of devotion open for everyone. He says that I am partial to my devotees, but then he allows everyone to become his devotees. So in that sense, he is impartial in allowing everyone to become his devotee, and he's partial in favoring his devotees. So Krishna, when he is impartially partial, what this means is that sometimes we think of impartiality as equivalent to neutrality or a stone-like neutrality. Now say, if we approach someone and somebody goes and criticizes that person, and that person just stone-like stoicness is there, and somebody goes and praises that person, and again stone-like stoicness is there. Now we may appreciate the stoicness of that person, but you know, how much of a personal relationship can we develop with that person if they don't exhibit any emotion at all? If they are stone-like in all ups and downs, then how would we ever develop a relationship with them? Relationship involves reciprocity. So Krishna is not just a neutral principle. Krishna is a living, loving person. So his impartiality is not a stone-like neutrality. His impartiality is actually reciprocity. Reciprocity means the more somebody serves Krishna, the more Krishna reciprocates with that person. And this is not partiality. Because the devotee has served Krishna more, Krishna reveals himself more. One time Srila Prabhupada was asked that, do you love all your disciples equally? And Prabhupada said, yes. And then he added, but if someone comes forward to render service, I reciprocate. If someone comes forward to render service, I reciprocate. Like parents, they love all their children equally. But if, as children grow up, they start taking up responsibilities in the family's business, the family's responsibility, actually the parents feel more connected with their child. So like that, Krishna, he is reciprocal. He reciprocates. And here, the gopis are recognizing that Radharani must have loved Krishna the most. And that is why Krishna has left with her. So they are, rather than becoming jealous, oh, you know, why is Krishna gone with this gopi alone? They're appreciating both Krishna and Radharani. They're appreciating that Radharani must have done some special service. She must have specially worshipped. And that's why Krishna has gone with her. And they are appreciating Krishna also. Krishna is reciprocal. Krishna is not partial in the sense of being nepotistic or just arbitrary. If somebody renders more service to Krishna, Krishna reciprocates. Now, in the Anand Vrindavan Champu, which is a book written by Srila Kavikarnapur, which especially describes the pastimes of Krishna in Vrindavan, this same pastime is further elaborated. And it said that, from here, the gopis are speaking, anayaradhito nunam. See, that this gopi must have worshipped Krishna very specially. So although they are at one level feeling bereaved that Krishna is not with us, at another level, they are appreciating. This gopi must be very special. So in the Anand Vrindavan Champu, actually, Krishna's and Radharani's feelings are described. So initially, when Radharani sees that Krishna has gone with me alone, that Krishna has left everyone and come with me, Radharani is overwhelmed with joy. Oh, Krishna loves me so much. You know, actually, you know, love can be one way, but loving relationship has to be two way. You know, we can love someone, but there won't be much of a relationship if that person doesn't love us back. And so therefore, if we love someone, there is some happiness in that. You know, we find that person attractive, we want to do something for that person. But when we see that person is reciprocating with us, then the ecstasy becomes much more, the joy becomes much more. So similarly, here when Radharani sees that Krishna loves me so much, that Krishna has left everyone else for my sake, her heart's joy knows no bounds. But as she is feeling such joy, suddenly a natural selflessness also comes up. And she starts thinking, you know, what will be the condition of Lalita? What will be the condition of Vishakha? What will be the condition of Tungavitya? You know, how shattered, how devastated they will be in separation from Krishna. And if they are separated from, if they are feeling such agony, how can I feel ecstasy? You know, I'm happy to be with Krishna, but I don't want my happiness to be at the cost of their misery. She started thinking what to do. Krishna has come with me alone, and Krishna is taking her deep into the forest. So at that time, she starts thinking. And she starts thinking, we are going so quickly into the forest. She knows that the gopis, they will not just sit peacefully if Krishna has gone away. They'll be frantically searching, where is Krishna? Where is Krishna? And they will come looking for us. And she also knows that, you know, they will look for our footprint, they'll find us. So what she says is, she tries to slow Krishna down. And she says, Krishna, Krishna, I want this flower. Krishna, I want this fruit. Krishna, can you get this tree? Can you get this branch? And in that way, Krishna panders to her requests. And there's a flower that is way up. So Krishna lifts her up. And Krishna lifts her up. What is Radharani thinking? Not just that, oh, Krishna is lifting me up. She's thinking that if Krishna has to lift me up, then what is going to happen? The footmark is going to go deeper into the ground. And then other gopis will be able to find me. So she is thinking, she is reciprocating with Krishna, but she's also thinking of the other gopis. And finally, she thinks that, oh, the gopis will be just, we are going too fast inside, we are going too far inside, so we should stop. And in order to stop, she tells Krishna, Krishna, I am very tired. I cannot walk any further. So, now her purpose in saying this is, she wants Krishna to stop over there itself. She wants to stop Krishna over there and then the other gopis will catch up. But Krishna exhibits a viparit bhava. Krishna apparently gets angry. And he says, O queen, because this is a forest, so I cannot get a palanquin to carry you. Therefore, you can get on my back. And I'll carry you on my back. And as Krishna speaks this, and sometimes when we speak, it is, we are speaking something, but our tone speaks more than our words. You know, if somebody says, you know, I love you, I will say I love you, but there is so much anger, there is no affection over there. So like that, Krishna is telling Radharani that, you know, because there is no palanquin over there, I'll carry you on my back. But the tone with which Krishna speaks, this is not of affection. This is of annoyance or anger. Radhani turns around, she's surprised to see Krishna's mood. And she looks around, she says, Krishna has disappeared. Krishna has disappeared. And when she says, Krishna has disappeared, she becomes shattered. And now she realizes that Krishna got angry with her. And being angry with her, Krishna has left her. So she's frantically begging Krishna, please come back. Please come back. And in the Kavikarnapur actually describes that Radharani, she goes so mad in her separation from Krishna. The word that Chaitanya Charan uses is premonmad. Mad is madness. Prem is love. So premonmad is the madness out of love. So because of which what happens? She knows that Krishna is not there, but she feels that Krishna is somewhere here. He's hearing. And she has like imaginary conversation with Krishna. She says, Krishna, please come back, I'm all alone. How can I be without you? So Krishna says, all the other gopis are also alone. You know, they are just as they are able to live alone, you can also live alone. Radharani says that, no, but you know, they are not alone, they are at least with each other. I'm completely alone. Krishna, please come back. So Krishna says that, yeah, but they will soon find you. They'll come back. You will be with them. She says, no, Krishna, I cannot live without you. Please don't leave me and go away. So Krishna says, you know, those who become proud, I don't stay with them. Radha says, no, I was not proud. I love you. I love the gopis also. I wanted them to be with you. That's why I did this. But Krishna still is angry. Krishna says, no, I wanted to be with you alone. Why did you not cooperate with me? I don't like such. So Krishna, and that's why I left you. And Radharani says, Krishna, but you know, I felt the gopis would be in such great agony. That's why I did this. And Krishna does not reply. And then when that happens, the gopis swoon. Radharani actually fades. And Kavikarnapur describes that actually Nidra is sleep, Murcha is unconsciousness. And he says that actually the goddess of unconsciousness comes to save Radharani from the unbearable pain of separation from Krishna. That pain was so great that she would have died. She would have just have died. And in order to prevent that death, what happens is, the goddess of unconsciousness comes and she makes her unconscious. See, normally, the human body, of course, now all this is transcendental. Radharani's body is transcendental. There is no question of death. But this is a Leela going on. And in the Leela, whatever is required for enhancing the emotion that is described, that happens over there. So although in the spiritual world there is no disease, Krishna may sometimes get a headache. That is simply Leela. So like that, here it is described that see, normally the human body has a finite capacity to tolerate pain. And if the pain becomes too unbearable, then the body just, as a defense mechanism, it switches off to unconsciousness. Like in movies, sometimes we may hear, see sometimes that, you know, somebody gets a news that a loved one has passed away. And then they just fall unconscious. Why? Because that pain is so unbearable that either it can be physical pain or it can be emotional pain. So a defense mechanism of the body when there is unbearable pain is fainting. So like that, when Radharani finds the pain of separation from Krishna unbearable, she faints. And then at that time, the gopis are searching for Krishna and for Radharani. And the gopis were searching. They say, oh, Krishna came here, Krishna went there, Krishna went there. And then they finally come and they see Radharani sprawled on the ground, her hair disheveled, her hands are stretched out. You're standing at one moment calling out to Krishna, please come. And then, it's without even beginning, I was just, she faints. And the gopis look around. They call out Radharani. One of the gopis runs nearby pond, gets some water. And they get her back to consciousness. And then, all the gopis, they ask Radharani, what happened? Radharani says that actually Krishna has left us and left me and gone away. Radharani tells the whole story. So the gopis, initially, they felt, oh, this gopi must be very special that Krishna has left all of us to go with her. But then when she say, they see that this gopi also has been left by Krishna. So then immediately there's empathy. And they all, they try to console Radharani. And then they all together beseech Krishna to appear. And they try to search for Krishna, they can't find him. They go back to the banks of the Yamuna. That is the place where they have performed so many pastimes with Krishna. And their hearts filled with the remembrance of Krishna, and they start calling out to Krishna. The beautiful prayer started from Jayati Tedhikam Janmana Vraja Shrayata Indira Shashwadatrahi Daita Drishyatam Dikshutavakas Tvaidhrutasavas Tvamichinvate. The gopis are praying, Krishna, ever since you appeared in Vrindavan, Vrindavan has become the residence of the goddess of fortune. Everyone here is blessed with good fortune. And yet, we are suffering from the unbearable misfortune of being separated from you. Please, reveal yourself to our eyes so that we can serve you. Please come back. So, Jiva Goswami has elaborately analyzed these prayers both in the Gopal Champu and in the Sandarbhas. And there he describes that each of these prayers is offered by different gopis. And he identifies this prayer is offered by Tungavidya, this prayer is offered by Lalita, this prayer is offered by Vishakha. Let's say different prayers are offered. And finally, when Radharani offers her prayer, Yatte Suja Charanam Braham Staneshu. So like that, all the gopis offer their prayers and the gopis' mood is Krishna, come back. And finally, Radharani's mood is when she's offering praying to Krishna, come back. She is saying that actually, Krishna, separation from you is causing us unbearable pain. But even greater than the pain of separation from you is the thought that your tender feet are being pierced by the pebbles, by the thorns, by the branches of Vrindavan. Nalina Sundaram Nathate Padam Shila Trunankurai Sidatitina Kalila Tammanaha Kanta Gacchati. So when we think that your tender feet is being cut by the pebbles of Vrindavan, that thought is cutting our heart apart. So Krishna, please come back. Please come back. So in this way, when the gopis pray fervently to Krishna, Krishna reappears. And then the delightful pastimes which are performed. So here in this most exalted pastime, which Radharani's supreme love is demonstrated. Actually, that supreme love is demonstrated in multiple ways. First is in her readiness to give up everything, even her reputation for Krishna's sake. Then it is demonstrated also through Krishna selecting her as his sole companion. And that love is also demonstrated through her concern for the gopis even when she herself is present with Krishna. And her love is also demonstrated through her fervent prayer, which ultimately causes Krishna to reappear. So actually the whole Rasala pastime demonstrates the supremacy of the love of Srimati Radharani for Krishna. And Srila Prabhupada on Radhashtami day, Srila Prabhupada started from India to America just a few days before Janmashtami. He celebrated Janmashtami on the Jaladuta. And then he celebrated Radhashtami a fortnight later. Still, he was on the ship It was a 40-day tour almost. It takes 40 days for him to reach. So there, on the, he remembers Radharani. He says that actually, that when Radharani becomes pleased, then all blessings will be showered. All blessings will be showered. And then it's interesting that Prabhupada quotes Radharani's, quotes or rather connects Radharani's mercy with the success of the preaching mission. He says that when Radharani's mercy will be there, then the holy names of Krishna will be chanted all over the world. Then every town and village will be blessed with the mercy of Krishna. So Prabhupada actually has a very special mood of Radharani. What was that? See, Radharani was alone with Krishna. Radharani wanted all the other gopis also to be with Krishna. And Prabhupada writes in a purport in the Bhagavatam that actually a pure devotee wants to increase the service of Krishna. And thus the devotee wants that not only be you be, that not only the pure devotee oneself, engage oneself in entire service of Krishna, the pure devotee wants to engage more and more people in the service of Krishna. So Prabhupada's pure devotion was manifested in his dedication to get more and more people to come closer and closer to Krishna. And he traveled far and wide. In a sense, Krishna played his flute and Sarva Dharma Antaritya. The gopis left everything and came to Krishna. Now for Srila Prabhupada, you know, when he came to Vrindavan, there were many people of his age who would come to Vrindavan. But they would come more or less to retire from the world. And the temple, when Prabhupada was staying, he literally stayed at the Radhadamoda temple. Before that he was staying at another temple, the Vamshikopal temple. And there, the pujari of the temple was surprised. This Swamiji, this person, he's coming and going. Then he's come here. Why is he again going back to the city? He's coming, again he's going. So many times when people grow old, they take a vrata, I'll never leave Vrindavan. I've come to Vrindavan and I will leave my body in Vrindavan. And the hope is that by living like this, we will be liberated. But Prabhupada came to Vrindavan not just to relish Vrindavan. He came to Vrindavan because he wanted to share Vrindavan's joy with the world. And Prabhupada, at one level we can say Prabhupada left Vrindavan to come to America. But that is the external understanding. Now, Prabhupada did not leave Vrindavan to come to America. Prabhupada left Vrindavan to bring Vrindavan to America. No, the pure devotee may leave the dham. You know, we can get a pure devotee out of the dham, but we cannot get the dham out of the pure devotee. The dham is always present in the heart of the pure devotee. And wherever the pure devotee is there, gradually the dham manifests. And when the dham manifests, there also the service of Krishna, there also the worship of Krishna manifests. So Prabhupada, in a sense, the sannyasi in those times, for an elderly person to leave Vrindavan was considered, you know, why are you leaving? Are you so attached? Now you come to Vrindavan, stay in Vrindavan. For a sannyasi to cross over the ocean, to go to the lands of the people where people are degraded, was considered to be not a proper sannyasi duty. But Prabhupada did not care about all these dharmas. His concern was Mamekam Sharanam Raja. For him, just as in the gopis, Krishna played the flute and the gopis left everything to please Krishna. Similarly for Prabhupada, the purpose of pleasing Krishna was supreme. And for that purpose, what did he do? He left everything else. Came all alone to the distant land of America for the sake of fulfilling Krishna's desire. For getting the lost souls to come to Krishna. So actually, the gopis' mood is not just, you know, they're loving Krishna, they're absorbed in Krishna. Yes, they're absorbed in Krishna, but they're absorbed in Krishna in a way that will please Krishna. So Prabhupada was also absorbed in Krishna. Prabhupada could have been absorbed in Krishna in Vrindavan also. He could have been chanting Krishna's names, hearing Krishna's pastimes. But Prabhupada was absorbed in Krishna in a way that could please Krishna. And that meant he wanted to get people to come closer to Krishna. And whatever it took to do that, he was ready to do that. And by Radharani's mercy, Prabhupada traveled all over the world And in his final days, he again came back to Vrindavan. And it was in the month that is considered special for Radharani, the month of Kartik, the month that is specially blessed by Radharani. At that time, by Radharani's blessings, by Krishna's blessings, Prabhupada departed from this world. So actually, the mood of Radharani is the mood of absorption in Krishna for the pleasure of Krishna. And that is by getting more and more people to get connected with Krishna. And that is the mood that Srila Prabhupada had. And Srila Prabhupada, by serving him, he has opened the doors of Vrindavan for all of us. So Prabhupada, when he translates Radharani, he translates, or he uses the double honorific Radha, Srimati Radharani. The purpose is that we don't misunderstand, that we don't consider that this is simply a male-female interaction. Actually, it is pure, it is transcendental, it is selfless. And historically, there has been a lot of misunderstanding where people think that this is just a male-female interaction and people imitate that. So Prabhupada was very, very careful that, you know, that Radharani is a worshipable deity. And that worshipable position of Radharani is conveyed through Srimati Radharani. And for us, what we learn from Radharani is the mood of selflessness. That we don't just want to enjoy Krishna for ourselves. We want to actually share the joy of Krishna Bhakti with others. And in that, although it appeared as if Krishna was displeased with her, Krishna left her. But I'll conclude with this point. In Anandavan Champu, it said that why did Krishna leave Radharani? And if Krishna went alone with Radharani to prove the supremacy of her love, the speciality of her love. But then why did Krishna leave Radharani? That also was to demonstrate her love. Actually, love is expressed through union and love is also expressed through separation. So when Krishna became separated from Radharani, the intensity of her ecstasy was so great that is celebrated, that is exalted. And actually, later on, toward the end of this last pastime, Krishna says, "Oh Gopi, is the kind of service you have rendered, I cannot repay that service. Na parayeham. I cannot do anything for you. Just be satisfied with this service." So, in that separation from Krishna, Radharani's absorption in Krishna increased even more. Radharani could have got angry with Krishna and said, "You know, you misunderstand me. You know, I was not doing this for myself. I was doing this for others." She could have become angry with Krishna. But her love for Krishna was so great that even when apparently there was rejection by Krishna, Krishna left her and went away. What happened? Radharani's absorption in Krishna increased all the more. That is the mood that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu demonstrates in the last verse of the Shikshashtakam. Ashrishyava padartam pinashtumam adarshanam marmahatam karotuva yathatathava vidhatulam pato matprananathas tusa eva naparaha. That ashlishyava padaratam pinashtumam adarshanam marmatam karotu adarshanam. If when I don't see you, what is going to happen to me? Marmatam, my heart is going to be shattered. But still, even in that condition, mat prananathas tusa eva naparaha. You and you alone, O Lord, are my Lord, no one else. Vishwa Pitama describes, Narada Bhakti Chitra also describes, that the test of love is when there is every reason for that love to be broken and it doesn't break. In all our relationships, you know, we have something goes wrong, we feel, I'll just end this relationship. It says pure love is when there is a reason to break that loving relationship, but then still that relationship doesn't break. And that is pure love. So when Radharani, in her selfless service to Krishna, through her caring for Krishna's devotees, for the other gopis, when she is apparently rejected by Krishna, she doesn't reject Krishna. She in fact becomes more absorbed in Krishna. And so Krishna, he doesn't go away from Radharani because he's angry with her. But rather, he wants to in a special way demonstrate the supremacy of her love, the selflessness of her love. And as through this whole pastime, the Rasleela, it's not just Krishna performing pastime to the gopis, it actually the selflessness of Radharani's love is being demonstrated. And to the extent, we can also develop even a fraction of that service attitude. We all can move closer and closer to Krishna. More and more of Radharani's grace, the Ladini Shakti, can manifest in our heart. And then we can also, our service can please Krishna more and more, and we can experience ecstasy that Radharani constantly embodies and that Radharani constantly enriches everyone with. So I'll summarize. I spoke up today about Radharani on her appearance day, and in this verse it is said that this gopi must have served Krishna in a special way. That is why the gopi is saying Krishna has gone alone with her. I talk about the five chapters of Raslila, the brief overview, and then before we can understand the Raslila, Prabhupada is very careful. He uses Radharani's name only once in the Bhagavad Gita, and he uses the double honor of Shrimati and Rani. Why? Because he wants us to be not misunderstand. And the misunderstanding is very possible because it can seem like a male-female interaction. And to avoid that misunderstanding, I discussed elaborately about how actually God is not just the best of all beings, he's the basis of all being. And that means that everybody is expanded from Krishna, everybody's existence is sustained by Krishna. And Krishna and Radharani are the same person. So God is satisfied within himself, but he wants to share his completeness with others. It's like a person who is happy and wants to dance to express that happiness. So to share his completeness, Krishna manifests himself in another form. And that form is Radharani. So Radharani, she gives, by everything that she does, she gives happiness to Krishna. And she also, for those who want to serve him, serve Krishna, she manifests in their heart and she gives them ecstasy. So she gives ecstasy to Krishna and she gives ecstasy to the devotees of Krishna who are trying to serve. So philosophically, Radharani is not a person different from Krishna. Practically, of course, she is a different person and she has her own mood, and sometimes she does what Krishna wants, sometimes she does something other than what Krishna wants, but that is also for the pleasure of Krishna. And her defining characteristic is her total selflessness for the sake of Krishna. And that we discussed in the Raslila pastime, wherein Radharani, first of all, she is ready to give up. Radharani, along with all the gopis, are ready to give up even their own perception of chastity for the sake of pleasing Krishna. For the sake of God, the bad has to be given up and even the good has to be given up. Krishna doesn't say sarva dharman parityaja, he says sarva dharman parityaja. And then, at an external level, it may say that Krishna leaves the gopis because they become proud, but that is external. Actually, Krishna leaves the gopis because he wants to demonstrate the sublimity of the love of Srimati Radharani. So if the gopis act proud, that is simply so that Krishna can demonstrate Radharani's special love. And eventually, when Radharani acts as if she is proud, that is not pride. That is her concern for the other gopis. And when Krishna acts as if he is angry, he is not angry. He is actually trying to reveal the glory of Radharani's love even when he is separated from her, when she is separated from him. And Radharani's love is not just her absorption in Krishna. It's her absorption in a way that is pleasing to Krishna. Srila Prabhupada, he connects Radharani's mercy with the success of the preaching mission. And he says, the mood is that Radharani wants Krishna's service to expand. That Prabhupada wants more and more souls to come and serve Krishna. And Prabhupada left Vrindavan and he carried Vrindavan with him wherever he went. He manifested Vrindavan. Prabhupada's devotion for Krishna was manifested through his dedication to bring others to Krishna. And if we follow in his footsteps, we also try in our capacity to try to share Krishna's message with more and more people, then by his mercy, we will get Radharani's mercy and we will become also absorbed in Krishna. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So let's offer one prayer to conclude. This is a prayer from Chaitanya Charitamrita itself. Devi Krishna Mai Prokta, Radhika Paradevata,
Radhika Paradevata,
Sarva Lakshmi Mai Sarva,
Sarva Lakshmi Mai Sarva,
Kanti Sammohini Para,
Kanti Sammohini Para.
So Devi Krishna Mai Prokta, Radharani is the goddess who is filled with Krishna completely, permeated with Krishna. Radhika Paradevata. She is a transcendental worshipable deity. And whatever is present in all the goddesses of fortune, all that and much more. Sarva Lakshmi Mai Sarva. All that is present in her. Kanti Sammohini Para. She is so effulgent that normally the illusion deludes the material world. But Radharani is attractive is such that it deludes even Krishna. He is Madan Mohan Mohini. This is the supreme glory of Shrimati Radharani. Shrimati Radharani ki
Jai!
Radhashtami Mahamahotsav ki
Jai!
Any comments or questions? Do you have time? Yeah, please.
Thank you so much, Prakash Prabhu. I think you did an excellent job of establishing the tattva, so we can appreciate the special position of the Leela and explain the Leela. And I wanted to offer a comment and appreciation. Maybe you can tell me if I've understood correctly. I really appreciated how you took this most exalted of all pastimes, the Rasa Leela, and this most exalted of all personalities, and you made them both actually immediately present for us through Srila Prabhupada's mission. Because sometimes we find tendency, consciously or unconsciously, you know, somebody would come to ISKCON and there may be some feeling in which, well, you know, Srila Prabhupada is giving an elementary thing, actually, but really it's about Radha and Krishna, and so we have to do something different. Whether that means going to Radha Kund and having some different practice there, or even within our own temple, well, you know, we should chant Jai Radhe, because, you know, she's the greatest devotee, even though Srila Prabhupada didn't do it. And things like that, I'm not against that as a principle, but just this tendency to kind of think that there's something not there. But I feel that you really brought out for us this mood that Srila Prabhupada is actually acting under her shelter, and her desire is to manifest this movement as manifested through Mahaprabhu's mood. It's not only in her own mood. So am I correct in understanding that the best way we can actually connect ourselves with Srimati Radharani is to understand that when we're chanting Hare Krishna, when we're calling it the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, not the International Society for Radha Consciousness, it's because she wants to put him in front. It's actually, she's the supreme boss of this entire movement in that sense.
Okay, yeah, that's true. So,
sometimes people feel that we don't talk enough about Radharani. And actually, Radharani is desiring to spread this movement. That's why we have International Society for Krishna Consciousness, not Radha Consciousness. Because if Radharani wants to glorify Krishna, yes, definitely. The most important thing in entering Vrindavan is not just talking about Radharani or talking about Krishna. It's actually developing the mood of purity by which we can appreciate. So, actually, there may be many people who talk a lot about Radharani, and some of them may be very exalted. We don't have to paint everybody in a negative brush, but there are many who just talk about Radharani and Radha and Krishna, but actually, they have completely distorted understanding. You see, what happened in Vrindavan is, there is, along with the Bhakti tradition, the Vaishnava tradition, there's a Shakta tradition. And the Shakta tradition has the idea that the goddess manifests in people. So in their tradition, sometimes you go to tradition goddess temples. So there, sometimes people just start dancing and like crazy. It's as if the goddess is manifested in them. So they have. So what has happened is, there are some Sahajiyas who actually started claiming that when we start hearing Krishna Leela, when we become absorbed in Krishna Leela, then Krishna enters into the body of the male and Radha enters into the body of the female. And when the male and female are interacting, it is actually Radha Krishna enjoying through them. It's a completely distorted understanding. It's completely distorted. So, but unfortunately, they started not only engaging in immoral activities, but rationalizing it by misusing the concept of avesh. So, because of that, our acharyas have been very, very strong. So, in not letting this syncretic idea, syncretic is, you know, conflating two different traditions, mixing up two different traditions, and coming up with a heterodox understanding. So, we do wish to also relish the pastimes of Radharani and Krishna, Radha and Krishna, but there has to be progressive. Progressive means that we have to become purified, and that purification happens through service. So the defining characteristic for entering into Radha Krishna pastime is not just hearing those pastimes. It is actually hearing those pastimes in a mood of service. See, if we hear, I'll talk more about this in the evening class today, but if we hear Radha Krishna's pastimes in the mood of an enjoyer, then our enjoying mentality gets triggered. But if we hear it, so if we see, to the extent we see Radha Krishna as a male and a female, to that extent, hearing about their pastimes will trigger our mundane desires. But to the extent we start appreciating that Krishna is God and Radharani is a devotee, to that extent we develop that spiritual vision, to that extent we'll actually start seeing the sublimity, the spirituality of that pastime. And that requires a lot of purification. So without that purification, we will simply misunderstand. So if that purification is there, see, even if we don't hear directly about Krishna, even if we don't hear so much about Krishna's Vrindavan pastimes or whatever, but if we are purified, then at the right time, the love for Krishna will manifest in the heart. See, the manifestation of the love for Krishna is not just by our hearing. Yes, our hearing is important, but ultimately it is Krishna's mercy. It is by His mercy that the love manifests. We may hear Bahu Janmayadi Kade Shravana Kirtan. We can hear for a long time, for many lifetimes. But if we do not please Krishna, if we are somehow offensive, then love will not manifest. So the point which I am trying to make here is that it is so that the manifestation of pure love for Krishna in Vrindavan comes not just by hearing about Krishna in Vrindavan. It comes by pleasing Krishna, pleasing Krishna's representatives. Comes by purification and revelation. And without that purification and revelation, even if we approach Krishna's intimate pastimes, actually we'll misunderstand them and we'll contaminate ourselves. So even if, yes, somebody argues that Prabhupada has given a basic message. Now, Prabhupada has given the Chaitanya Charan, in which a lot of esoteric truths are also revealed. And Prabhupada never said that you should not read previous acharya's books. It is not possible that if Krishna is infinite, so, you know, Krishna, the books glorifying Krishna will also be infinite. And Prabhupada has given us the way to connect with the whole tradition. He's given us the whole tradition. And so one extreme is to, you know, to disconnect Prabhupada from the tradition. The other extreme is to disconnect the tradition from Prabhupada. That means to access the tradition, I have to, you know, Prabhupada is preliminary, I leave him behind and go ahead. Or the other is that, you know, we disconnect Prabhupada from the tradition, and we say that you know, we never discuss anything about Krishna or Radharani because Prabhupada did not discuss it. No, Prabhupada gave us the books and he wanted us to discuss. So like I mentioned yesterday, there are many Prabhupada disciples, senior devotees, who are translating the Acharya's works, who are commenting on them, who are speaking on them. So they are giving us access to the tradition through Prabhupada. So basically, if some devotees very strongly feel that, you know, we want to hear about Krishna, then they can take the blessings of the spiritual master or the spiritual guides. And from those who are sheltered with Prabhupada, they can hear. So all of us have our own individual relationship with Krishna. And how we advance, it varies from person to person. Yena kena prakarena mana Krishna niveshit. At our level, we have to fix the mind on Krishna. So nature of the mind is that it is always dissatisfied. You know, if we have a lot of service, the mind says, oh, I don't have time to study Shastra. And then if we get a lot of time to study Shastra, the mind will say, okay, you know, how many books will you study? Do something practical. No matter whatever situation we are in, the mind will not be satisfied. So even if we are not controlled that mind, even if we hear about Krishna's esoteric pastimes, no, we will not be satisfied by hearing those pastimes. We will want to tell the world, hey, you know, I know how many special pastimes I know. And therefore, you should understand I am a special devotee. So we are not relishing that pastime, we are actually simply relishing the ego, and the pastime becomes the means by which we boost our ego. So actually, the connection with Krishna comes by purification and revelation. And if some devotees feel inspired to hear, there is facility for that. But so it should not be that devotees who want to hear about Krishna, they're told you should not hear it. Especially the devotees have spent some years, they want to hear, that's fine. But they do it in a way that is consistent with Prabhupada's mood. And those who are engaged in the preaching mission, they're doing practical activities. If somebody wants to serve Krishna in a particular way, there's no need for them to make others feel that you are doing something less. No, if somebody is doing distribution, somebody is doing deity worship, somebody is doing temple management, somebody is doing preaching basic concepts. All these are also ways in which we are serving Krishna. And all these can also take us to Krishna. Because through all these, we will get purification and we will get revelation. And then we will come to Krishna. So basically, the point that different devotees can have different inspirations in bhakti. And there can be, within the broad umbrella of what Prabhupada has given us, there can be different definitions of success. So building a big temple can be a definition of success. Distributing a lot of books can be a definition of success. You know, youth preaching can be a definition of success. You know, discussing the Bhagavatam and getting into the Acharya's commentaries can also be a definition of success. And it is not automatic that just because somebody is discussing the Bhagavatam, that means that person is more advanced than somebody who is doing book distribution. No, actually the advancement will depend on one's dedication. Somebody may be doing book distribution with a selfless mood, and somebody may be discussing esoteric pastimes of Krishna with a self-aggrandizing mood. Then they will not go, who is closer to Krishna and who is further to Krishna is not dependent simply on who is talking directly how much about Krishna Lila. It is based on how selfless one is in one's heart, in the mood of service. So we can, if some devotees feel inspired, there is facility within our movement also for those devotees to hear more about Krishna in a way that is faithful to Prabhupada and in a way that is that can take them and others closer to Krishna. But what is not appreciated is thinking that, you know, there is a, that everybody else, they are just doing basic things and I am going to do something special. And by doing something special, I will get a shortcut to Krishna. No, you know, the only way to Krishna is through purification and revelation. And how that purification and revelation happens is through a service. So as a service, if somebody wants to study Krishna Leela, that's wonderful. As a service, if somebody wants to do youth preaching, that's wonderful. As a service, somebody wants to do distribution, that's wonderful. Prabhupada gave us a whole legacy in which all these are important parts. The problem comes when we make one thing as the only thing. We start thinking, you know, because I am doing this, I am special, and everybody else, they are doing something else, it's not important. No. If we see studying the Bhagavatam, studying the Acharya's commentaries also as a service, and some devotees will be inspired to do it, and that's fine. They shouldn't create insecurity among others. They do it themselves and others do the service which they are inspired to do. And we can all move towards Krishna. And we can have a vibrant bhakti tradition, living bhakti tradition, where, you know, all aspects of the bhakti tradition are available to people. Does that answer your question? Any comments or should we stop here?
Yeah, it answers the question.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Srimati Radharani ki. Radha Shri Mahamahotsav ki. Prabhupada ki. Gaur Bhaktavrinda ki. Gaur Prema Vrinda.